church people at. Oh, come on, it's a triumphant entry today. Come on. Lift your voice. Hosanna, he has come. Let's sing. Aren't you thankful for that amazing grace? Aren't you thankful for what He has done for you? It's amazing to me this season how beautiful it is, how wonderful it is to walk with Jesus, to see what He saw, and to experience what He experienced through the words of Scripture. And I'm in awe of what He has done. Amen, church? Who's thankful for what He's done this morning? Let's sing about it now. Worship comes as an expression from the heart in response to what God has done for us. My sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. I thank God for what He's done. A debt I couldn't pay. Something I owed, but I couldn't pay. And Jesus said, I will go there for you. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall still repeat. Can we sing that again? Come on, church. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white and snow. Yes, sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white and snow. Can we just worship him right now? Come on. Lift our voice. Come on, sing it. Jesus paid it all. Jesus
on our own, it wouldn't matter. He paid it all. Amen, church. You can be seated. Good morning. Happy Palm Sunday. What a beautiful day to be here in the house of the Lord. We're so glad that you're here. I told Darren I would get out of the way, and I didn't. Sorry about that. Good morning, church. Go ahead and get out your tickets for the impossible shot. You should have gotten a ticket at the door. In just a minute, we are going to draw numbers for a chance at the impossible shot. This is not something you want to miss, ladies and gentlemen. The impossible shot is coming, but so is Easter Sunday. Next Sunday is Easter. I can't even believe it. It's coming so quickly. We hope that you will join us for our sunrise service, 6 o'clock, right outside. I've said it before, I'll say it again. It'll be a little bit chilly, but it'll be totally worth it. It's a beautiful time of worship and testimony with our church family. We would love for you to join us for sunrise service and also for our regular services at 9 and 10:30. Invite your friends and family. We will have the Easter egg hunt immediately after the second service outside in all the grassy areas. There will be so many eggs, you can't even count them. So many kids, you can't even count them. It's going to be a great time. If you have recently given your heart to the Lord, whether that be in the last couple weeks as Pastor John has been giving the invitation, or maybe a few years ago or whatever that looks like for you and you have not gotten baptized, we have an opportunity in 2 weeks, April 7th, for you to get baptized. If you would like to do that, you can contact me, you can go to our website, you can fill out a connect card in the seat pocket in front of you and check baptism. We would love to have you get baptized on April 7th. That's going to be in 2 weeks. It is a command from our Lord, and we would love to help you obey that command. If it is your first time at Parkway, welcome. We're so glad that you're here. The first time you're a guest, and after that, your family. There is a connect card in the seat back in front of you, like I said, or if you'd like to stop by the Welcome Center on your way out, we would love to connect with you and say hi, and thanks for coming. Also, if you're new, whether this is your first time or second time, in 2 weeks, on April 7th, we will have a new friends party. New friends party is one of our favorite days of the year. We get to connect with you. We get to put a face to a name. And you get to meet us. You get to meet Pastor John and the staff, hear a little bit about Parkway if that's what you want to do. Or you can just come and eat a free lunch. We're going to have smushed ice cream, the cookie sandwiches. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Those are really good. That's worth coming for. You can come to the new friends party also on April 7th. Pastor Andy, we've been waiting. We've been prepping for this impossible shot. The time has come. We're going to draw some numbers here, people.
All right, here we go. You guys ready to have a little fun?
Yeah.
That's the important thing. We're going to call some numbers here in a minute. And as we call the numbers, if your number's called, come stand right here on the X. Make a line this way. And then we're going to start the impossible shot. Let's go ahead and start pulling some out. How about ticket 3264888. If your number's called, come right up here. 3264888. How about 32?
All right. As promised, we are going to do our own little, I guess, impossible.
Our trivia. Own impossible shot. Yeah, impossible trivia.
Impossible trivia. Impossible shot. So we threw a question up earlier. Mm-hmm. I'm going to put it up again for you. Who does this logo belong to?
I know the answer to this one now. I didn't know yesterday.
Yeah.
And it's first of all, should we tell them what the logo is?
Yeah.
I'm going to tell you what the logo is. So the logo, if you can't tell, maybe you know, maybe I didn't know. I couldn't tell what it was. The logo is actually a peacock. Okay. So maybe you could tell that, maybe you couldn't. And I'm going to tell you what, there is no more fierce animal in the animal kingdom than the peacock.
Oh no, I'm about to be attacked by a peacock. it doesn't strike fear.
Although
in me.
I've heard they're quite ferocious. I mean, they still got that beak. I mean, they gotta have the I mean, they gotta be, you know, somebody's gotta be scared of them.
I don't know. I mean, and this, I will say, this team was in the tournament, but they're not anymore.
They're not anymore.
So put in the chat what you think that answer is. I'm going to go ahead and give them the answer.
Let's just give them the answer.
This is kind
practice.
Of the test question. So here's your answer. It is the St. Peter's Peacocks.
St. Peter's Peacocks.
That terrifies me.
I think they should have gone kind of like Notre Dame. Could have gone like the Notre Dame, the Fighting Irish. They could have been the Notre Dame.
I like that you
St.
mentioned
Peter's.
Notre Dame there.
I thought I'd do that for you.
Appreciate that.
Yeah, just for you.
Yeah, yeah. All right, so here is the first service official question. So we have a different question for both hours. Mm-hmm. Here is the official question for first hour. Here we go. This is a good one.
Oh, have I seen this one?
This is the one I showed you yesterday.
Oh, yeah,
So it should be on your notes there.
I didn't believe this. Did we fact check this? I didn't believe the answer when you showed me this yesterday.
Yeah.
I didn't believe this.
Well, it was funny because Darren was like, no shot. And I was like, actually, I can't say it because I want to get the answer away. But I was like, actually, it was this many shots. So we got Lynn is standing right here in front of us. Lynn, what do you think the answer to this question is?
I think 11.
11. He thinks 11. So
that's a fair guess.
If you trust Lynn, then say 11. So basically what we will do is we'll give the answer at the end of the service today. We'll pick a winner. We'll go back and look at all the comments and try to see on every platform who said it first. So what is the NCAA tournament single game 3-point record? Man, Darren, what did you say it was yesterday?
So, my thought, I think I said 10. Yesterday, I think that's what I said. I can't remember. But see, here was my thought, right? We're talking NCAA, right?
Right.
My
right.
man, Steph Curry, the greatest 3-point shooter of all time, come fight me, right? I think I've seen him hit like 17 in an all-star game where defense doesn't exist.
Yeah.
Right. So I'm thinking the man, Steph Curry, the greatest of all time, and when it comes to 3-point shooting, if he's hitting 17, these kids in college, they can't be hitting that many more, right? And in college, they still play defense.
Yeah.
Right? Which that's a whole nother argument we won't get into.
Right.
But, so my thought was 10, right? Now, in case you're wondering, I was wrong. Just throw that out there.
Well, there you go. The answer 10, is not 10. There is
wrong.
Your hint for the day. The answer is not 10. And listen, you can't cheat on this. I mean, you can, but you could Google it. But when I say you can't cheat, second hour, we're going to have a different question. So, yeah.
Yeah, that would be tough to cheat because it's, you know, different. Can we, hey, by the way, can we just call out something? You look way better than me. I know we said we were going to do the jackets, but I thought we would do, like, T-shirts or something.
You took my breath away,
but
man.
But you put the tie on.
Yeah,
you
man.
Put the shirt on. How many people have asked you if you're preaching today?
You know, I've kind of been tucked away in the corner upstairs, so nobody has asked yet. And they probably assumed it's Palm Sunday. There's no way they're letting the bald guy with white glasses preach today, so...
Well, you know, that's all right.
Well, but look, you can probably tell a little bit on your screen there. We are showing a real-time shot of what is happening in service right now with the impossible shot.
Yeah, somebody just airballed it. I couldn't tell what they were shooting with.
Was it as bad as my airball last week?
No, it was, well, I don't know. It might not have been quite that bad.
So first hour last week, I made it with no problem. No, like I had practiced.
It was beautiful.
Yes.
With the rubber chicken and everything.
Yeah. So what have they shot so far? I can't see the screen from where you're at.
All right. So my man in the vest looks like a basketball. So it's orange. So we're going to call it a basketball.
All right. We're shooting a basketball.
Let's see. And shout out to the donkey. Oh,
nobody has won yet. I'm getting confirmation that nobody has won yet.
Okay,
so
nobody has won yet.
Shooting, they're not as good as I am. So,
hey, not everybody was in the NCAA.
Well, Division II. Let's clarify that.
D2.
I played Division II. Did not start a single game, but I played. You know, let me share a cool little story about that. And maybe just take a moment and not to pat myself on the back or anything, but to I guess, get some people to never give up. So I don't know if I've shared this with you, but, man, I didn't start a single game in high school.
Yeah.
In fact, I was cut the first 2 years that I tried out. But then I was the one of two people from my high school that went and played college basketball.
That's awesome.
Because I continued to work. I continued to just hone in my gift and my skill. And so I just, you know, don't give up. You know, it's kind of like those Cinderella stories. You know, you like look at NC State right now. You know, NC State had to win 5 games to win the ACC championship. They've played 7 games now in 12 days, I think it is, and they are still dancing. That is life in a nutshell. Do not give up. Just continue striving. Continue trying. Continue pressing on. Listen, hey, don't forget to answer the question in the chat. But also let us know in the chat that you're here. We didn't get a chance to say that earlier. We showed some videos and had a little bit of fun earlier, but we didn't get a chance to say that. So put in the chat. Let us know that you are with us today. Let us know that you are worshiping. We got a prize. We're going to give you a gift card for anybody who can the first person. I don't want to say anybody.
Yeah.
Okay. The first person who answers that question right. It sounds like somebody
won
in the building.
Let's see.
We have a winner. Oh, I love it.
Yeah, I hear the music.
I wish you guys could hear it. Oh, man. You know what? I'm going to cut in there for a second.
Let's do it.
Maybe. Oh, no, I'm disconnected. Oh,
so
we'll
close.
Just keep rambling on here. So we got.
Yeah, I just saw it. We got
a winner. Awesome. Did it go in?
Yeah, I get. We're super delayed.
I wonder what they were shooting. What did they shoot?
I don't know. Pastor Andy might have given them a little bit of help.
I was just told they shot a donkey.
They shot a donkey. Man.
That sounds so bad. Lucky. Like they took a shot with a donkey. They did. We did not shoot a donkey in our service today. All right. They took a shot with a donkey, a stuffed donkey, I'm assuming.
I sure hope so. Although there is a live donkey down there.
Yeah. We're going to cut in there for just a moment. It may cut our audio, but I want to cut in there for just a moment. And then we'll come right back to you guys.
Give me the basketball. There you go. First line. I've given up on that second line. Oh man. Nice try. Spin
762012.
A crazy spin. He really wants this thing. Can you dunk it from the first line? Down? Okay. Donkey! Here we go. Alley oop, maybe. Yes! All right! With no help, he is a winner!
And they stay there.
Thank you so much for playing the Impossible Shot.
Let's go.
And the confetti. Oh, that worked out great.
And the confetti. Oh, man, that's all over the stage now.
I was slightly afraid that I overfilled the confetti
cannons. This was great. All right.
I might have.
Well, that was great. You can take that now.
Don't you love how spiritual we are in our church today? I want you to turn. Am I on? Can you hear me, y'all? Okay, bless your heart. Turn in your Bibles to John 16. Once you find them, flip over and also find Acts chapter 1. While you're turning, how many of you have been watching March Madness? Now, we talked about this impossible shot. What you might not be aware of, how many of you watched JMU whip up on Wisconsin two nights? What you might not be aware of is that one of our own, our janitor's son, was number 22. From Northside, and he scored 12 points. Watch this.
Been on the floor quite a bit, and it's taken away by Friedel. Friedel driving, dishing, and the layup goes.
That's his boy right there.
Scrapping the ability to run out. Friedel does this. How about this? The attack, the dish.
There he is again.
Spin by Edwards.
Three-pointer.
And he can hit that shot. Confident left hand there. Nice pass.
Two-man game.
Good pass. Extra. Wooden rocks the rim.
A little buddy ball from the big guys inside.
Great passing inside. Carey finds his open teammate Wooden to get stops here.
Well, how many of these going to do?
Wooden drives hard.
Now, the next time you see Solon, he's our janitor, and that's his oldest boy. He's going to be here today. I think he's coming to the second service. He works here, but he doesn't attend here. Found out yesterday he didn't have a church. So we're going to roll out the red carpet, all right? And I told him if he'd come, we'd give his boy a standing Parkway ovation. Let's give it up for Jalen. Come on, let's give it up. Amen. Now, if you see him, some of you who know him, point him out to some of the Parkway people, give him a good greeting, and tell him we're celebrating his son. And I promised him that even if JMU ended up playing Purdue, which is from Indiana, that I will root for JMU and for his boy, because he's one of our own, right? Can I get a witness on that? All right, now I think we're finally ready to get all spiritual. John chapter 16, verse 7. John 16, verse 7. But very truly I tell you, it is for your good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. Acts 1:3 through verse 5. After his suffering, note that, after his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was what? He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak of. For John baptized with water, but in a few days, you will be baptized with what? What one carpenter built. What one carpenter built with three nails and a rock. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for the cross. Thank you for those three nails that you allowed to hold you there. Thank you for the suffering. And thank you for the empty tomb. Thank you for the rolled away rock. If it wasn't for that sacrifice and that victory, we wouldn't have our comforter today. We wouldn't have our salvation today. Thank you for what you built with those three nails and that rolled away stone. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said. Amen. How many of you have ever tried to drive a nail? Ever tried to drive a nail? I mean, it should be a simple thing, right? My dad was a carpenter, and so I've driven my share of nails. But you ever put the nail in the wood, and you're supposed to kind of tap it, you know, to get it started? And then you take your hand away because you don't want to hit your thumb, and then the nail just folds over. Has that happened to any of y'all? Or how about when you get it started, and so then you start whamming away, and you don't hit it even, and you start bending the stupid thing, and you're almost in with a circle, and you got to start all over again. Has that happened to anybody in this room? Have you ever watched a professional carpenter? It's like poetry in motion. We got some of you here. You know, Johnny, I bet you've driven a few nails in your day. And where, Jonathan, wherever you're at. Oh, right beside your mother. If you watch these guys, or if Gene, I don't know if Gene's here or not. I remember Gene came over with a Gene Cash with a couple of his team, and we were enclosing a park, yeah, that's it. Whatchamacallit? Something you drive your car through? Carport! What is the matter with me? And we were going to turn it into my office, and we needed to frame it up. I'll never forget watching Gene Cash drive nails. It was like the hammer was an extension of his arm. No nails flew over, or sometimes you ping them and they take off, you know? That never happened with Gene. Just bang, 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 bang. It was almost like as fast as a nail gun. My dad was a carpenter, built a lot of homes. I remember showing up on a Saturday morning with Dad and Pastor Cockrell. They were the only ones that showed up because it was raining. And they were laying a center block, and they had their mortar board where they mixed up the mud, and it started raining. And Dad grabbed three Pepsis, three bottles, not the cans, the bottles. This is back in the old days. And we got underneath that mortarboard because that's the only place you could stay dry. And I wondered, you know, we didn't have a can opener. My dad took a nail, bang, 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 in a 2x4. And he popped those cans off the lid, whatever you call that thing. It's going to be a great morning. pop those caps off those. And we sat there and drank that lukewarm Pepsi. And I watched my dad. You know, he drove that nail and popped those things off. I thought, my dad, so cool. He doesn't need a can opener. You know, he just drives a nail. This whole month, we've been talking about what one carpenter built with three nails and a rock. And we've talked about 3 weeks ago, 3 or 4 weeks ago, we talked about how he built a bridge. So we had a way to God. And we talked about how he built a new heart. He didn't repair the old heart. He created a new heart because of those three nails and a rock. Last week, we talked about how he built the church. We didn't have the church until those three nails and a rock. And he built a family and how we knew whether or not we were a part of that family. And now today, I want to talk about something else that didn't happen until those three nails and that rock came along. This carpenter built a door. He built a gateway for the Holy Spirit to come through. If we didn't have those three nails and a rock, we would have never had Pentecost, which I know some of you don't even know what that is. But that's when the Holy Spirit came down and filled those boys, and they went out and changed the world. And it's that Holy Spirit that came after his sacrifice, after the nails, after the rolled away rock. It's that Holy Spirit that is in this room right now. Are you with me this morning? Now someone might say, well, so what? What's the big deal about the Holy Spirit? Three things. Three things that the Holy Spirit does for us. There's nobody in this house that can live a Christian life without the power of the Holy Spirit working in you and doing three things. Are you with me this morning? All right, just checking. If you can hoot and holler for that basketball, you can hoot and holler for the Word of God. Can I get a witness? Number one, the Holy Spirit doesn't let us get away with our shame. He doesn't let us get away with our shame. He confronts us with truth. He confronts us with our sin. In John 16, 8 and 9, when he comes, he will prove the world to be wrong about what? Sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin because people do not believe in me. Galatians 5, 16 and 17. I say, walk by the what? The Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. Powerful statement. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other. Anybody relate to that? Can I get a witness? They are in conflict with each other so that you are not to do whatever you want. The Holy Spirit helps us not get away with our shame, with our sin. You know, we're very willing to confront everybody else's failure, right? We're very willing to point out everybody else's fault and everybody else's sin. But there's not a person in this room, I don't care who you are, that doesn't have a tendency to want to cover up your own. And we got to have the Holy Spirit. It's like David and Nathan, you know, you're the man. If you know your Bible, we have to have that Holy Spirit to come in and say, you know, that's wrong right there. In fact, I would dare say in this room right now, the Holy Spirit's coming along and saying, you know, that's not quite right. You know, he's talking about me, I'm in your life, and that's wrong. Has an uncanny ability to take his finger and point to the truth. And we all need that. I was reading about a lady, a professional genealogy researcher. Her name is Judy Wallman. For a living, she traces ancestors. And she found out that she had a common ancestor with Harry Reid. Remember Harry Reid, who was the senator from Nevada? And he was the Democratic senator from Nevada. And he was head of the Senate from 07 to 2015. And this guy was named Remus Reid. And he was an ancestor of both this professional researcher and Harry Reid. And so she did some research on him, found a picture of Remus Reid, and on the back of it, this is what it said. Remus Reid, horse thief, sent to Montana Territorial Prison in 1885. escaped in 1887, robbed the Montana Flyer, which is a train, the Montana Flyer, six times. Caught by Pinkerton detectives, convicted, and hung in 1889. How'd you like to have an ancestor like that in your tree, you know? So she contacts Harry Reid's office, you know, this political office. Says, are you aware of this common ancestor we have, and have you done any research? So they send her this version of Ramus Reid. And this is what it said. Ramus Reid, a famous cowboy in Montana Territory. His business empire grew to include acquisitions of valuable equestrian assets and intimate dealings with the Montana Railroad. Beginning in 1883, he devoted several years of his life to government service, finally taking leave to resume his dealings with the railroad. In 1887, he was a key player in a vital investigation run by the renowned Pinkerton Detective Agency. And in 1889, Remus passed away during an important civic function in his honor when the platform on which he was standing suddenly collapsed. Man, if that isn't a twist on the truth, can I get a witness on that? And guys, we all do that. We all want to sugarcoat our offenses and confront everybody else's offenses. And we all need the Holy Spirit to come in and say, you know, that's not true. You know, that's not right. You crossed the line over here. Hear about the father that told his son not to swim in the canal. Don't swim in that canal. And that evening, the boy comes home and he's carrying a wet bathing suit. And the father said, did you swim in that canal? And he said, well, yes. And he said, didn't I tell you not to swim in that canal? And he said, yes. He said, why did you disobey me? He said, well, I had this swimming pant, this swimming trunks, and I crossed the canal, and it's just too much temptation. It's too much temptation. So the dad says, well, why were you carrying the swimming trunks? And he says, well, I wanted to be prepared in case I came into temptation. I'd be ready to go. We all need the Holy Spirit to lead us into the truth about ourselves. No one in the house can follow Jesus without that Holy Spirit. The second reason we need him, the first reason is he doesn't let us get away with our shame. The second reason, the Holy Spirit helps us to stay in the game. I want you to look at John 14:16. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor, a comforter, to be with you forever, the Spirit of truth. You know him, for he what? You know what? I know what the problem is. When I wrote this thing down, I wrote it in the old New International Version. My devotional Bible is the old New International Version, and so it's a little different. So I messed up. That's my fault. Let's start again. The Holy Spirit told me to tell you that. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor, a comforter, to be with you forever, the Spirit of truth. You know him, for he lives with you. And you will be, and will be in you. I will not leave you an orphan. I love that. Galatians 5:22-25. But the fruit of the Spirit, you know this verse, is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep step with the Spirit. The Holy Spirit not only confronts us with our sin, but he comes in and he counsels us and he comforts us and he helps us to stay in the game.
to try to get the yo-yo up and down, out of our life, and to be a consistent, dependable Christian. Are you with me this morning? Amen. I remember a fella who bought a Rolls Royce. You know, it doesn't get much better than that, right? A Rolls Royce. And he put it on a ferry. And he goes across this English Channel. He wants to spend a two-week vacation driving his Rolls Royce all over Europe, right? 2 days in, the Rolls Royce breaks down. Something goes wrong. And so he calls the company back in London and says, my Rolls Royce is broken down. Can you help me? The very next day, a mechanic arrives and works on that Rolls Royce and gets it in peak condition. And that guy drives the rest of his two-week vacation without any problem whatsoever. When he gets back to London, he writes a letter to Rolls Royce asking them how much he owes them for sending a mechanic all the way across the channel to France and to fix his car. And this is the letter that he gets back from Rolls Royce. Dear sir, there is absolutely no record anywhere in our files that at any time, at any place, or for any reason, there was anything ever wrong with a Rolls Royce in our files. And never got a bill. You know why? Because that's a company committed to excellence. Now listen to your pastor. You have a Holy Spirit that has a design on your life. And he wants to make you into a solid, beautiful, dependable, consistent Rolls Royce. Not the jalopy in your backyard that's held together with bumper stickers and rust and starts on a lucky day. Can I get a witness this morning? God has a design, a purpose to make you consistent in your walk with Jesus Christ. Have you ever considered how easy it is for the enemy to come in and rob you of your victory? Rob you of your peace. Allow something else to get in control of your life. Son comes home, gives his daddy his report card. He's a senior in high school, and he's flunked a course. And it hits the fan. I mean, his dad goes ballistic because he has a dream for his son to go to the same school he went to, which was an Ivy League school, Dartmouth or something like that. And with that failed grade, there's no way he was going to make it. And the son said, it wasn't my fault. This teacher, he wasn't fair. And so the dad heads to the school with a rain cloud over his head. And he walks into that, and he goes into the classroom, and he lays that thing down and accuses this teacher of being unfair and unjust, and that he's going to keep his son out of this Ivy League school. And the teacher says, you know, look, I gave my best shot. He got the grade he deserved. I can't change it. And the guy says, I'm going to have your job. And he goes down the hallway. Now this rain cloud's turned into a thunderstorm. He walks into the principal's office, walks right past the secretary, walks into the principal's office and says, I need that guy's job. He's cheated my son. And he's not going to have the career he deserves because of one stupid class. And he just gives him both barrels. And the principal is familiar with the situation because the teacher anticipated this coming. And as he's taking both barrels, he just waits and he waits until finally this dad takes a breath. And at that moment, the principal doesn't come in and charge help with a water pistol. He doesn't even try to defend himself. You know what this old veteran principal does? He turns to the father in this moment of silence and he says, sir, I can tell that you love your son very much. And it broke him. The emotions just flooded. The anger just went out. That's what the Holy Spirit does for us. If we were honest with ourselves, there are moments when we are unbelievably unchristlike. Can I get a witness on that? There are moments when we're not passing the grade. There are moments, if we are honest with ourselves, we're blaming everybody and everything, including God, for something we're responsible for. And we all need this Holy Spirit to come in at just the right time, in just the right way, and say, your issue is right here. And I can help you with that. Are you with me this morning? To break the control that comes in. Whatever the enemy uses, anger, depression, temptation of some kind that gets into control. We've got to have something bigger and powerful than ourselves. We can't get out. We got to have help. And the Holy Spirit comes along in just the right way and breaks that grip and keeps us in the game. Are you with me this morning? What could there be? What handle is there in your life that the enemy has a tendency to get a hold of and take you out of control and take you to a place you shouldn't go? That's when we need something bigger than ourselves to come in and break that grip. Can I get a witness? The Holy Spirit won't let us get away with our shame. And the Holy Spirit will help us stay in the game, not disqualify ourselves. And the third reason why we need this Holy Spirit that was able to come because of three nails and a rock is that the Holy Spirit helps us slay in God's name. I'm going to explain that in a minute. He helps us slay in God's name. I want you to look at John 14:16. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor. Be help if I get on the right page. Acts 1:8. But you will receive what? Power. When the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and to the ends of the earth. John 16:8. Then the Holy Spirit comes. He will convict the world of guilt in regard to sin and righteousness and judgment. Ephesians 6:17. Take the helmet of salvation and the what? The sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. What makes me struggle over 21st century American Christian culture? Do you know what grabs me, convicts me, even in my own life, about how we're running our race these days? We never play offense. Never. We're constantly playing defense in our walk with God. What is the enemy doing? Where is the enemy hitting? And how do I need to react to him? We never seem to take the offense. You know, we talk about the armor. And I realize, and this is a good point, that almost all the armor is defensive. And it is important to have a defense because the enemy's on attack. He's a prowling lion, the Bible calls him. And we need that defense, the helmet of salvation, the shield of faith, the breastplate of righteousness, all that is defense. But there is one offensive weapon. What is it? The sword. And it's called the sword of the Spirit. And that is offensive. We're supposed to make him react to us. We seem to be incapable of doing that. You know what I could do? I could take some of you old timers, some of us with the spare tires, And I could enter this March Madness thing, and we could win the whole thing with two conditions. You know what they are? The other team, JMU, Purdue, whomever you want to pull out, Houston, they have to play defense the whole time. The whole time. And we play offense. Now, it might take us half a year. Okay? We run our play and they just swat the ball away, or we shoot some stupid shot and they get the rebound. But when they get it, they don't go down the court and score. You know what they do? No, here's the ball. Try it again. And so we try it again. They get the ball. Okay, try it again. And we just keep doing that for about 2 or 3 weeks. But the other condition is, as soon as you make the score, you win, the game's over. You see, guys, I don't care how big our spare tires are. I don't care how gray our head is, or there's no hair at all. Thank you. Sometime, someplace, somewhere, the stars are going to line up under the rainbow, and somebody's going to throw this banana shot, and it's going to go through the net, just like what happened here. The game's going to be over. We're going to win. The guy who plays offense all the time is always going to win over the guy who plays defense all the time. There is a sword. It's the sword of the Spirit. And it's an offensive weapon. Don't you think it's about time to make him react to what we're doing? Instead of the other way around? Hear about the two boys, brothers. They're painting their Easter eggs. And there's still a bunch of eggs that their mother hasn't boiled. And the older brother turns to the younger brother and he says, I'll give you $1. I'll give you $1 if you let me crack 3 of those eggs over your head. And the younger brother says, promise? He says, oh yeah. After that third egg, I'll give you $1. He says, okay. So he takes one egg and right on top of his head. Towards the front of his head, so it goes all the way down his face, and all the way down his front. And so he takes a second egg, boom, on the back of his head, goes down his neck, goes underneath his shirt. You know, can you imagine, you know, a raw egg just rolling? And so he's sitting there, he's just waiting for that third egg to come. And he's waiting and he's waiting. Finally, he opens his eyes and says, when are you going to hit me with that third egg? Says, I'm not. That's going to cost me $1. Now, there's a kid playing defense, waiting for the next hit. A lot of Christians like that in this room. A lot of Christians just cringing, waiting for the next hit. It's not supposed to be like that. We're supposed to take the offense every now and then, charge hell with a water pistol, make him react to us. I'm going to show you a picture. You know this guy? We have a picture of him. His name is Al Braca, B-R-A-C-A. I hope I pronounced it right. In that picture, he's 54 years old. He's a deacon at his church. His wife's name is Jeannie. His son's name is Christopher. He was, let me get this right. He was a corporate bond trader for Cantor Fitzgerald. I think I said that right. He absolutely hated his job. Hated every bit of it. He would have gotten out of it, but he felt like he was called. Both he and his wife felt like he was called to reach the people in his office for the Lord. They called him the Rev, and it wasn't a compliment. It was a slam, because he was constantly trying to live out his faith in front of these co-workers. He felt like he was supposed to be a light in a dark place. So even though he hated his job, for the sake of the cause, for the sake of the mission, he stayed there. You know where his office was? Anybody? The 105th floor of the North Tower on September 11th. When his wife turned on the TV and saw what was happening, she knew that Al would be in the thick of it. Because that's what he did in 1993 when they tried to blow up the towers the first time. He went into action and ministered to hurting people. But she never, ever dreamed that Al would never come home. And she would never see him again. Took a week for them to find what was left of his body after being crushed. It took about a month and a half before the reports started coming in about her husband. Because some of the people on that floor had enough time to call their loved ones after they knew that they weren't going to make it out. And they started talking to their loved ones over the phone about this guy who was praying with everybody and counseling them and helping them. Some sent some emails and even used Al's name. There's a guy up here trying to help us, trying to minister to us. And when they determined that there were no exits, and this was it for them, there were reports that Al got everybody together in the outer office, that middle part, over 50 people, and started telling them how they could know for sure they would make it to heaven. And talked about Jesus. How they could know for sure they had eternal life. Were they ready? That's important to me. You know why? Because on a day when the whole world was playing defense, there was one guy. One guy in the fire who was playing offense. And when those towers went down, there were 50 people that were salvaged from the kingdom of hell. And they woke up that day in the kingdom of heaven. Because Al Braca played offense. The Holy Spirit is calling you to play offense. And the most important offensive play. In fact, you can't play offense until you make this offensive move. Is to make sure you're ready for heaven. See, Al couldn't have done squat that day if he hadn't known for sure he was ready for heaven. If Jesus walked through those doors, would you know for sure you had eternal life? Would you know for sure you would go in to heaven and meet your Savior? I've asked that question for 35 years, and the answer is always the same. A few of you who would be honest enough with yourself and with me, there's a few of you, a handful, that would say, Pastor, I know I'm not ready. I know I'm not, because what's in my life, what the Holy Spirit's putting his finger on, I know that I'm not ready. There's about half of you that you are ready. No question in your mind. If he walked through those doors, you'd have a party. You'd be ready to go. But sandwiched in between these two points is about half of you. That if you were honest with yourself and with the Lord, you would have to say, I'm not sure. I hope I am. You might even say, I think I am. But to say for sure, Right now, the Holy Spirit is coming and he's whispering in your ear. He says, you know you're not sure. You know that you're not confident. And guys, that is a spiritual problem. Because the Bible says in 1 John 5:13, I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God so you can know you have eternal life. God never meant for it to be a guessing game where we stand with him. We can know. And if you were honest, you would say, well, Pastor, how can we know? How can we know for sure? Well, the Bible talks about four steps. It talks about confessing. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We have to be willing to admit to ourselves that we need this eternal life. That we got some things in our life that aren't right. And the Bible talks about repentance. To turn from those things. It's like going in the wrong direction and you're kind of lost and you confess to yourself, this is the wrong way. I don't know where I'm at. And you turn. Repenting is to turn and go the right way and never be wanting to go the wrong way again. The Bible says, repent then and turn to God that your sins might be wiped out, that times of refreshing might come from the Lord. And then the Bible talks about believe. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Believe in two things, who Jesus is and what Jesus did. He died on that cross and he rose again, the Son of God. And then finally, the Bible talks in John 1:12, to those who receive him, to those who believe in his name, he gives the right, not the privilege, the right to become children of God, part of the family. Someone might say, well, Pastor John, what if I want to receive him, but he doesn't want to be received? You don't know how dirty my heart is. There's a promise in the last book of the Bible where Jesus says to all of us, behold, I stand at the door and knock. The door of our heart, the door of our life. He says, if anybody hears my voice and opens that door, I will come into him and fellowship with him and he with me. That means if you're willing, Jesus would come in. And you might say, well, how do we do that? You do it in prayer. You go to the Lord in prayer and you take the four steps. Lord Jesus, I confess my sin. Lord Jesus, I want to repent of my sin. I want to turn from what I know is wrong in my life. And then, Lord Jesus, I turn to you because I believe you're the Son of God who died for me. And I want to receive you into my heart and life as my personal Lord and Savior. And guys, if you can pray that prayer and really mean it in your heart, I believe you'll never have to doubt again where you stand with Jesus Christ. You can know because God's word says you can. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads with me. Close your eyes. Please honor me in this. Every head bowed, every eye closed. I'm going to pray that prayer. If you're not sure where you stand with him, I'm inviting you to pray this prayer with me. Please hang with me. Every head bowed, every eye closed. You don't have to pray this prayer out loud. You can pray it in your heart. Just say, Lord Jesus. Repeat that in your heart. Lord Jesus, I confess my sin to you. And Lord Jesus, I want to repent of my sin. I want to turn from what I know is wrong in my life. And Lord Jesus, I turn to you because I believe you're the Son of God who died for me. And right now, by faith, I reach out and I open the door of my heart. I open the door of my life and I invite you in as my personal Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name. Now, if you were able, heads bowed, eyes closed, just me and the Lord looking around, if you were able to pray that prayer with me and mean it in your heart, would you be willing just to slip your hand up? Because I want to pray over every hand that goes up. I want to see every hand. If you prayed that prayer, keep them up. It's going to take me a little while. And I don't want to miss one single hand. Keep them up. Don't put them down yet. If If you prayed that prayer and meant it in your heart, if you just slip up your hand, good, keep them up.